to love me when you're lying to another. That's not love, that's just wishing. Wish and love are not the same.
Listening to Pop Adult on Stingray Music.
this kind of beauty. It's got no reason to ever be shy. Cause honey, this kind of beauty, the kind that comes from the side.
Could you be?
So bright, bright, so
the same constellation that you and Jupiter conspire to get me. I think you and the moon and Neptune got it right. Cause now I'm shining bright, so bright, and I get lost in your eyes. Did you see that shooting star tonight? Were you dazzled by the same constellation? Did you and Jupiter conspire to get me? I think you and the moon and Neptune got it right. I think you and the moon and Neptune got it right. Cause now I'm shining bright, so bright, bright, so bright, bright, so bright. And I get lost in your eyes tonight.
Enjoy Stingray Music Free.
Didn't like it when I wore high heels, but I do. Turn the lock and put my headphones on. He always said he didn't get this song, but I do. I do. Walked in expecting you'd be late, but you got here early and you stand and wave. I walk to you. You pull my chair out and help me in, and you don't know how nice that is, but I do. And you throw your head back laughing like a little kid. I think it's strange that you think I'm fine.
So, folks, if I could have your attention. So we'll get underway in about 5 minutes. So if you do need to grab any refreshments or do anything in preparation for our talk tonight at 7 o'clock, so we'll get underway in about 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we'll get underway. I think we'll get underway. I always like to honor those folks that are on time, not those that are not on time. So I think we will get underway. I just have a couple of brief words as introductory comments. We'll then introduce our guest speaker for the evening, Mr. Ken Dryden, and we'll get things underway. I know a number of folks were waiting to have photographs taken and to speak with Mr. Dryden just previously, but we will take a bit of time right at the end of the talk today, about 8:30 or so, to provide an opportunity for those that might want to speak with Mr. Dryden and to say hello and perhaps get a photograph taken. So, folks, my name is Richard Finch. I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Applied Health and Community Studies. I had a student council meeting last week, and one of the students said, "So who's this Richard Finch guy anyway?" Anyway, so I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Applied Health and Community Studies, and I have to say I'm absolutely delighted to be here to welcome each of you here. As I was making my rounds, I saw and met members from the community, many from far afield. So we have folks here from as far away as Walkerton, Ontario, from Kitchener, Ontario, Waterloo, Guelph. I understand also that Ken's former babysitter, Leanne Simpson was her name back in the day, babysitter, not the person that babysat Ken, but babysat his children, is here tonight. So welcome, Leanne. Lovely to see you and your partner here. On behalf of Sheridan's Creative Campus Advisory Council and our faculty, the Faculty of Health and Applied Health and Community Studies, I want to extend to each of you a very warm Sheridan welcome. It's so wonderful to have you here tonight. As I said, we do have quite an array of folks in the room tonight, and that's really, really gratifying for us and our faculty that have, over the course of the past year, had underway the what we have termed the Community Builder Series, really looking at ways to better build community. So it's very gratifying to see so many of you here. I want to acknowledge the presence, certainly, of our faculty members that are here, certainly all of our students that are here. I met a couple of alumni that were here tonight, certainly several of our PAC members, which are the Program Advisory Committee members. I also want to offer a special acknowledgement to Dr. Yael Katz, who's the chair of our Creative Campus Advisory Council, who so generously assisted us in supporting this initiative, but certainly provided in-kind and financial support for this evening's address. So thank you, and a warm welcome to all of you. I should acknowledge also that we have a number of members from the media here this evening. So I understand that we have folks here from the Brampton Guardian, from the Oakville Beaver. We have Kojiko TV here. We have also Sheridan Sun. Sheridan TV is also here. And I do want to acknowledge the folks from Sheridan Production House that have so deftly managed the cameras through our entire Community Builder Series over the past year. So thanks to Prunch and his crew. So welcome to you folks as well. Of course, I do want to extend a very warm welcome to our special guest, our very special guest this evening. I think the attendance in the room is testament to how special tonight's address is. I do want to welcome Mr. Ken Dryden. So thank you. Certainly an honor for our faculty, the Faculty of Applied Health and Community Studies, to be hosting this part of the Creative Campus Speaker Series. For those that may not be familiar, the Creative Campus Speaker Series is comprised of a selection of distinguished talks by dynamic speakers from a range of disciplines. And each talk addresses a particular aspect of creativity, and beyond that, creates an opportunity for interdisciplinary dialogue. And I certainly think that you'll find that tonight's talk occupies a special place in that series of talks. Tonight is also a very special moment for our faculty because over the course of the past year, we have, as I mentioned, we've held what we've called the Community Builder Series. And the Community Builder Series is really a way for our faculty to celebrate the important connections that we all have to community with our various disciplines. It's been an opportunity through various documentary screenings, through various events, various art shows, and various talks for our faculty to come together and explore our connections to community and to creativity and the important links to our disciplines, but also to the interdisciplinary of the work that we all do and that we're all committed to. The culminating event for our Community Builder Series is actually going to happen tomorrow. So tomorrow we will host the Community Builder Symposium. The symposium is a celebration of all of the community builder events that have taken place over the course of the past year. It's an opportunity for our faculty and our students to display and celebrate the great work that they have done. We'll have a number of learning cafes and discussion groups, some theater, and certainly some documentary presentations that were produced by our students together with the students from animation, art, and design. So we're very excited about that. And assisting us tomorrow in our Community Builder Series will be Mr. Ken Dryden, who will be present for that that symposium, and there will be an up-close and personal interview with Mr. Dryden. The interviewer will be Ralph Ben-Murgi. That will take place at about 10:45 tomorrow, from 10:45 until about 11:45, and that will certainly be broadcast on the Sheridan website and simulcast at various locations on the campuses tomorrow. So you can look forward to that. The event is really intended for our faculty and faculty members and students, but certainly participate by watching Sheridan TV or seeing the simulcasts that are happening tomorrow. I want to acknowledge, as we talk about the Community Builder Series, I do publicly want to acknowledge the very hard work of our faculty and certainly our students, and a special recognition should go to senior documentarian Laura Skye, who I think is here somewhere. Yeah, wave your hand there, Laura Skye. Laura Skye, who has really led the charge behind the documentary screenings in that portion of our Community Builder Series. So, with that, just a word about the media. So you'll notice that the tweets are being displayed on the side screens, and it's been very active since I got here at 6 o'clock today, so look for that. We're also being simulcast on Sheridan TV at the moment, and there is an overflow room outside where those that can't find space in the room will be able to see the simulcast. And so just very quickly, and then I'll turn it over to Ken's introduction. Very quickly, so the format tonight is that I'll be quiet in a moment. My mother always told me I talk too much, and I apologize for that. The format for tonight is that Ken will be introduced. He'll do his address for about an hour. So at about 8:15 or so, we'll wind up the address. There will be a question and answer period that I'll moderate. We'll have some microphones on the floor for you to access. And then at 8:30, we'll pause, and that will create an opportunity then for Ken to mix and mingle with you folks. So to that end, then I would like to call to the stage Professor Monica Lysak. Monica Lysak is a professor in our early childhood education program. She's also... She has also recently been elected as Speaker to Sheridan's Senate, and she's a very good friend of Mr. Ken Dryden, so please welcome Monica once again.
Thank you, Richard. It's my great pleasure tonight to introduce our Speaker, Ken Dryden. Ken is an iconic Canadian who is a champion in many arenas. He's a successful author, an educator, a politician, lawyer, businessman, and he is an officer of the Order of Canada. Some of you might even know that he was a goaltender with the Montreal Canadiens and the backbone of the team that won 6 Stanley Cups. Is that right? Yeah. The first time I met Ken Dryden, he was the new Minister of Social Development, tasked by Prime Minister Paul Martin to create the long-awaited National Child Care Program. I had a message for the minister. I said, you'll remember. Minister Dryden, you were a hockey hero to me in my youth, and I hope you will be a hero to me in my adulthood by creating that long-awaited national child care program. And as many of our early childhood students and faculty here tonight can attest to, you succeeded. Thank you. So I know some of you are here tonight to hear your hockey hero, a goaltender whose skill in the 1972 Canada-Russia Summit Series defined Canadian patriotism for a generation of us. Ken continues to share his vision for a better Canada, not only through his writing, but also through his work with young people at Canadian universities. He is a generous supporter of youth in foster care, providing scholarships to help them attend colleges like ours. When I say I look up to Mr. Dryden, it's not only because of his height. He continues to inspire me to be a better community builder and a better Canadian. Please join me in giving a warm Sheridan welcome to this exemplary Canadian and community builder, the Honourable Ken Dryden.
Thank you. Thanks, Monica. Thanks, Richard. And thanks all of you for being here tonight. It's I enjoy being on campuses. I'll get to that a little bit later, but I do very much. And it was interesting just in advance of the proceedings beginning and meeting people and having a chance to have photos taken. This past weekend, I was in Charlotte, North Carolina, and for almost every year, for the last 15 plus years, originally it was all of our family, which meant my wife and our two kids as well. In the last number of years, it's our son and I will go to one day of the first round of NCAA basketball, and either the Thursday or the Friday, and get tickets for the afternoon games and the night games. So it's four games in one day, and the challenge is to try to get access to tickets. The cost of the tickets isn't great, but the access is difficult. And so right up until Wednesday, I had a plane ticket, but I didn't have an arena ticket. And we finally got it worked out, and through the Raptors, and who I had when I was with the Leafs, the association with the Raptors, and they got tickets for me in the afternoon session from Michigan State, who was playing in the afternoon games, and at night through Duke, who was playing in the sessions at night. And so when this happens, you never know where your tickets are going to be. So you go to will call, get the tickets, start into the arena, and get directed by an usher. And the usher is sort of saying, well, they're down there. And so you go down a few steps and a few more rows and a few more rows. And all of a sudden, I realized that the A on my ticket wasn't superseded by double M, double, H, and so on, and that A meant A, and that we were right in behind the scorer's area, right in behind the Michigan State bench, and right beside Magic Johnson. And so, and who is really Magic? I mean, he is so good with people. And so when the game was on, that people stayed in their seats. When there was an intermission, they all came down and had pictures taken with Magic. And he was absolutely great with him, with them. And it was beyond the games, which are a real treat. That was an unexpected part of it. It is fun to be here also to meet people that I wasn't expecting to meet, and I've met a number of either present or former goalies, and they always introduce themselves with pride, as they should, and then also of seeing Leanne, who babysat our daughter when we were living in Centerville, when I was still playing with the Canadians, and Sarah, you know, would have been between 0 and 4 years old at that particular time, and in a very special part of Montreal. So that was a treat. As I said at the beginning, I love being around colleges and universities, and it's always been that way. And whenever I travel, if there's a college within 50 miles, I just happen to wander there. I like the look, I like the feel, I like the seriousness of colleges and universities, I like the energy, the excitement, the optimism, the learning, the important stuff that is going on there. Last summer, my wife and I went on a road trip, as each year we do. In this particular one, we flew to Chicago and rented a car and just headed off. And we headed off with our Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives books, and on back roads and secondary roads, and just in a sense sort of Googling across America. And one of the great things about Google is that when you take secondary roads and you go into towns that you know nothing has ever happened in those towns. They are 500 people, 600 people, 800 people, 250 people. You Google that town, there's a reference to them, and somebody came from that town. Unbelievably, but somebody came from that town, something happened in that town. And so what we usually do is we kind of have a rough idea of where we're going, and then we just kind of end up where we end up. And so we were heading towards ball games in Kansas City and afterwards in Milwaukee, to the Iowa State Fair, and then to all of the surprising towns along the way. And one of them, and we knew when we were in Iowa that we wanted to go to the area around in Madison County and see the covered bridges of Madison County. And it's a beautiful area, and not just the bridges, but one of the towns there is Winterset, Winterset, Iowa. And it just so happens that that somebody was born there and lived there until the age of 8, until his family moved to California, and that was John Wayne. And so this tiny little place in the middle of nowhere where nothing could ever have happened, well, something happened. And there was another, you know, in going another place in Iowa, Amana, Iowa. I mean, and anybody who remembers back far enough to Amana refrigerators and Amana stoves. Well, they came from Amana, Iowa. And Amana, Iowa was this a German community that started in the 1800s and kind of grew up as this special place where a special company was born and special appliances were made. And then there was this other place that we went to that was as much of a shock or more of a shock, and just driving into it, and it's called Blue Rapids, Kansas. And Blue Rapids, Kansas, as you drive in, you see this little community ballpark, and there's a plaque. So we stopped and read the plaque. And in October 1913, on that ball field, the New York Giants, now the San Francisco Giants, played against the Chicago White Sox in this tiny little town in Kansas at a time when ball players didn't make much money. And so after a season was over, they did what was called barnstorming. So they would go into these small towns and play, and sure enough, in Blue Rapids, Iowa, they played a baseball game. And the other things that we did, and as I said, we go to campuses. And so along the way, in Columbia, Missouri, to the University of Missouri, and then in Lawrence, Kansas, the University of Kansas, and Kansas State in Manhattan, Kansas, and then in Ames, Iowa, Iowa State, and in Iowa City, the University of Iowa, Drake in Des Moines, and then into Wisconsin, to Madison, to see the University of Wisconsin, and even to Monmouth College in Monmouth, Illinois. And my wife, when we both went to Cornell, and at that time she was a member of a sorority called Kappa Kappa Gamma. And Kappa Kappa Gamma was founded at Monmouth College in Monmouth, Illinois, 150 years ago or something like that. And so it's just, I mean, that colleges are so much fun to be around, to wander the grounds, to just feel what it feels like. And they are such creative places. It was one of the things that was fun driving in tonight and seeing the banners from the lampposts. And sure enough, what do you see on one of the banners? But, you know, Sheridan, get creative. Well, that's what universities and colleges are about. It's where learning happens. It's where futures get made. And they feel that way. And as Richard said earlier, talking about the creative campus. And of course that's what this is. And a college or a community is a big community in itself, but within a much larger community. And that's one of the things that's fun about, and I find it particularly interesting, urban area campuses. I went to Cornell University in Ithaca, New York. Ithaca is not a city. It is not an urban area. Cornell is beautiful. But if I had to, and 99 reasons out of 100, I wouldn't change anything having gone to Cornell. But I think urban campuses are far more interesting than rural campuses, and essentially because urban campuses, they understand the learning that goes on in the city around, all of those things that are going on in the city, all of the, you know, the dramatic, innovative, stunning, surprising learning that is going on around them and around that kind of campus, that those universities and colleges that really know what they're doing and function as they know they can, is that they make themselves part of that learning. It's not the separation of colleges and universities as the traditional notion of the ivory tower, but it's the colleges and universities in the midst of other learning and the other learning in the midst of colleges and universities. We talk and in terms of that kind of larger learning community, we talk more about community now, I think. And there surely are very few more evocative phrases than it takes a village. And I was involved in something that related to that completely to my surprise just over a year ago. I think, you know, it was, yes, just before the Olympics. And I had been approached at other times to do commercials, and I'd always turned them down. And so I got approached on this one, and I turned it down, and the person who is from the ad agency said, well, just read what it's about. And I read what it was about, and it was so interesting, and that I ended up doing it. And it's a commercial that if you were watching the month before the Olympics and during the Olympics, you would have seen. And it was a commercial that featured Jonathan Toews of the Chicago Blackhawks. And the way they did the commercial was they had Jonathan Toews sitting on the ice in an arena. It turns out it was the arena in Winnipeg, and Jonathan Toews is from Winnipeg. And he's sitting there, and he's sitting there with his parents on either side. And then as the shot pans back, it's you can see there's more people and more people and more people and more people. And there in the end, I think there were 160 people. They were all dressed in red, and they were people that were part of Jonathan Tave's life. His, you know, Adam coach, his Pee Wee coach, his some teammates from that time, the person who does the concessions in the local rink, the Zamboni driver, adding one person after another, the skate sharpener, adding up to 160 people. And I think the theme was something like, you know, we all cheer for Canada or something, or we're all, but essentially what the message was, it takes a village. It took that village of 160 people to create Jonathan Taves, the outstanding player. And of course, without that community, without that village, it wouldn't have happened. And all of us, you know, once we get to a certain age, we know that. You know, we realize that. When we're younger, we may not think that. We may think that, you know, that we're, whatever we have done is our doing, and maybe marginally somebody else. But really, that's not right. You know, that it took all of those people that were a part of our lives in order for these things to happen. But there are a lot of people who don't quite believe in a village now, or don't quite believe in a community. And that community that created the school, that created the healthcare system, that created the roads. And a lot, I think, is that there are a lot of people who feel as if they have the means to live beyond that village, beyond their village, to work and play in a larger village, in a global village. And so that the village that's right around them doesn't matter so much to them. And so that it becomes a real question, even though things like it takes a village is so evocative for us, that in the practice of our day-to-day lives, often it doesn't quite work out that way or feel that way. And so it really does become a question. You know, in today's world and tomorrow's world, do communities matter? Does community building matter? I grew up not that far from here. I was born in Hamilton, but we moved when I was a year old to Etobicoke. And that was kind of the beginning times of Etobicoke, that, you know, that there were some older buildings in Etobicoke and certainly some development down by the lake. But really the kind of building of Etobicoke and the booming of Etobicoke took place after World War II. And it became, you know, that western suburb of Toronto. And we were a part of that. I grew up in an area of Etobicoke called Humber Valley. And all the houses were new, including our own, and the churches were new, the schools were new, the playgrounds were new, and all of those things new at a time when it just felt completely special. And I remember, you know, driving downtown often for minor hockey games and driving by the oldness of the rest of the city and how unprivileged it seemed that those areas were, the old houses, the old schools, the old small playgrounds, the old arenas. And we were living this possibility in this new community, in this community that was kind of the new Canada and where the new Canada would be built from. And it was very much the understanding of my parents, and I think of virtually everybody's parents, is that you raised your child as parents, but that in fact the community around was hugely influential in terms of how, you know, the circumstances in which your kids grew up. I mean, it really mattered, the rest of the community, not just the house that you lived in, and not just the parent, you know, being a parents, but of the rest. And so it was just a very natural, normal thing for my parents and other parents to be involved in a service club. My father was in Kiwanis, other people were in Rotary or in Lions or in Kinsmen or in Optimists. My mother was in, you know, at the, in the church and sang in the choir at church. And my father helped coach teams. And those teams that he didn't help coach, other fathers helped in the coaching. And their understanding was that those coaches of our teams, those teachers in our schools, those people in our churches and on our playgrounds that were part of our lives really mattered. I mean, that whatever it is they did with us, whatever they tried to pass on to us, made a big, big difference in terms of how we would grow up. And that very much that it was part of a parent's job to try to see that the community functioned as well as possible, because that better functioning community was going to mean a better environment for their kids, for us to grow up in. And we were lucky. I mean, as lots of you in this room are lucky of having those special teachers that you remember, and those special coaches that you remember, and somebody else special that you remember, and that at times you kind of think back and wonder if that person wasn't around, you don't know quite where you would be today. And that's how special they were. Then I went to university at Cornell, and it was another really interesting and important community, and it was really important for me in particular because it was kind of a high energy, high ambition, athletic and academic place. That everything felt serious, but serious in an interesting and fun way. But if you did it, you did it well, and you expected to do it well. You were expected to do it well, and you had teachers that were at the top of their profession. You had coaches that were at the top of their profession, and you were in their midst. And what was really important for me, and something that I didn't quite realize until later, but was that all along I had gone to school and played different sports, and I was pretty good at both of those things, but part of the understanding was he's a really good student for a hockey player. Or he's a really good hockey player for a student. But I wasn't quite sure whether I was a really good hockey player or a really good student, or only under the circumstances I was good. And at Cornell, I had professors and I had coaches that essentially their message to me was, no, actually, you're pretty good at each of these things. And to think of yourself that way. Don't think of yourself as, you know, as the one thing in the context of the other. Think of yourself, you know, as each in its own context, and approach it that way and with that kind of seriousness and ambition. And that was really helpful. I mean, and really important, really important. And then to Montreal. And it was the same kind of thing. I mean, that people who have firsthand recollections of that time, and including me, will have thought that the Canadians were this powerhouse forever. And they weren't. The Canadians were not a powerhouse until the mid-1950s. And when they started with winning their Stanley Cups in 1956 and won five in a row, at that particular time, the Canadians had won seven Stanley Cups in their history, the same number as the Detroit Red Wings, and fewer than the Toronto Maple Leafs. That the Leafs had won, I think, the same, they had won seven, but the Leafs were also the Toronto Arenas before that and the Toronto St. Pats. These were not different teams. They were the same team that just had different names. So in 1956, the Canadians had won seven with the Wings and the Leafs had won nine. And it was in the next 24 years that the Canadians won 15 times and became sort of the legendary team. And then since that time, they've only won twice, you know, in the last 36 years, you know, or something like that. But you don't, you know, you arrive into this community and you don't arrive as somebody who is destined to win all the time. You are surrounded by all of these people who are really good at what they do. And I mean, if I can wish anything for, you know, for any of you, it is to have that experience in something in your life. To be surrounded by people who are really good at what they do. And to know what that feels like. And to experience it. I mean, it's so terrific because, again, you know, you cannot do it yourself in any area. You cannot do it in business by yourself. You cannot do it in sports by yourself. You cannot do it in politics by yourself. You just cannot. No matter how hard you try, no matter how good you are, you need others in order for this to happen. And for it to happen, you know that you are in their hands. And they know that they are in your hands. And you've got to trust those hands, and they've got to be good enough to trust for all of this to work. So here's this unbelievable good fortune, because you know, you get drafted. You could be drafted by anybody. And so I just happened to end up in Montreal. And happened to end up in Montreal in the midst of this explosion of success for the Canadians. And so to be a part of that community, and that community of, you know, of players who were the best players, coaches who were the best coaches, general manager who was the best general manager, arena that was the best arena, fans that were the most knowledgeable, passionate, and insistent fans. And so, you know, they were tough, but they were not inappropriately tough. They knew how good we were, and they didn't allow us to forget how good we were. And so if we were less than as good as we were, they let us know that we were being not as good as they knew we were. And that is a fantastic environment in which to do things. It's, again, it's not unfair. If the expectations were of something that you couldn't possibly deliver, then that's horrible. Then you know that there's no way, and it's just disappointment everywhere. Disappointment in those who expect, disappointment in yourselves, and so on. But you know, we had that in us. And so that kind of community mattered. It made us better. And then, after that, I had some other experiences of where you could see when a community doesn't work, you know, what can happen. I was the Ontario Youth Commissioner for a couple of years, and it was at a time of high unemployment, and of course what always happens with rates of unemployment is youth unemployment is always much higher than general unemployment, and it's usually about twice the number. So if it's 6% nationally, it'll be 12% for youth, and if it's 8% it'll be 16%, or if it's 10% it's 20%. Well, it was around 20%, you know, at that particular time. and going into schools, and who were, you know, who were so many of those students, or who are so many of those youth who were unemployed? They were those who had dropped out of school, and the dropout rates in the mid 1980s were far higher than they are now. And the question was, is that if the writing is so clearly on the wall of if you drop out, you're not dropping into anything, there's not a job there for you, then why would you drop out? Is to start talking to students and listening to students. And of course, you know, that you by the time you drop out, you've really kind of dropped out a year or two beforehand. I mean, you just haven't gotten it. You've fallen behind little by little by little, and you feel less and less, or you feel more and more stupid with each year that passes, with each class you take, and all of that just makes you feel so uncomfortable and so much not wanting to be there. And so, you know, that of experiencing that community as well. I did a book on somebody who others would describe as an average person. I wanted to write the biography of somebody who is most people but never gets written about, and to do it as a biography, just as you'd write a biography of a political figure or an entertainment or sports figure or business figure. Write a figure about somebody who is around 40, married, a couple of kids, lives in a metropolitan area, in a suburb, has a high school education, but not more, earns an average income. You know, what's that story? Where did that come from? How did he get from where he, you know, grew up in Whitby, Ontario, to Scarborough 40 years later? What were the circumstances? What kind of family did he live in? And so on and so on. And the set of understandings, whether they were there or not, the expectations, the hopes, the ambitions, whether they were there or not. And I met somebody earlier this evening who was a student at T.L. Kennedy in the mid-1990s when I went back to school for a year to write a book on schools by just sitting in class every day trying to figure out who's learning, who isn't, why, who's a good teacher, who isn't, why, and of getting to know students and how come this student, you know, has a 62 average and this student has an 88 average and they kind of look alike, and so how does it get to be that way? And how come tomorrow 62 can't be 72 on the way to 82? How come not? How come doesn't it happen? What could make it happen? And again, so much of it, you know, has to do with the surroundings, the expectations, the community within which somebody lives. In going to Ottawa, it was our job as members of Parliament really to understand the country. I mean, it was our job to represent a riding, but the first job is, what is this country about? And what is it about now, in 2004, 2006, 2011, and 2015? What is this country about? Not what we have been told it's about, what our myths will tell us it's about, not what our, you know, wisdom speakers, you know, will say, typically Canadian, eh? You know, when something goes wrong, as if things always go wrong, and that's the nature of this country, and that it will never be anything other than a country in which something could happen but doesn't happen, and typically Canadian, eh? I don't think so. I don't think so. For the most part, things work and work pretty well, and most international measures would suggest all of that. And so this stuff about typically Canadian A, of where we always fall short, maybe not so much. But maybe if that's the understanding, maybe if that's the expectation, that in fact it just cuts you off at the knees from understanding what you can be and being what we all can be. And so that was our job in Ottawa, was really to understand what we are now as a country and what we have in us to be as a country in the future. Part of the time there, and as Monica mentioned, of, you know, we were the government when I first began. I was the Minister of Social Development and working on childcare. And it was a wonderful task to have. I mean, this was at a time when the Liberals had been the government for 9 years or something like that. We were coming to the end. There were scandals. There were hearings that were going on. And things were starting to fall apart. And when they start to fall apart, then those who are in opposition get more and more excited, energized, hopeful. And that was the atmosphere. And we were really struggling. And I think I was the luckiest person in Ottawa because I had a task. I had a goal. I had a purpose that wasn't just sort of surviving to the next day and without the government falling and the rest of it, but was how do you create a system? Not how do you deliver a program. Programs have a beginning and an end. Programs have a finite amount of money and a finite amount of time. A system is something that can, you know, goes beyond the term of a program. It's like, you know, education systems that were built, healthcare systems were built, that once they come to be in place, they stay in place. They stay forever. And so how do you build something that is a forever and not 5-year program term? And so it was terrific, and working again with this kind of community of incredibly dedicated, involved people who believed in early education, and having that kind of community around, and then after that, and after it was defeated in the election of 2011, I decided to go back to McGill, and I had been a law student at McGill. But, you know, this time it was to go back with basically the same approach that I was trying to do in politics, of that notion of what is it that we are as a country, and then ensure that as a government that we gear our programs to what we are. And you know, and if we're here, then you gear them to here, not to the old understandings of being here and gearing programs there, and that the level of ambition and the dimension and all the rest of it is to what this Canada, you know, would want to do and do. So that was the idea of this course at McGill. Well, and I approached them and said, look, here's an idea. I would call it Making the Future. And the idea would be that the students who in the rest of their academic lives learn about the present of something and the past of something, this is to focus on the future. And say to students, you are going to be living another 60 plus years. You're going to be working another 40 plus years. This is your life. This is not anybody else's life. It is your life. What kind of life do you want to live? What kind of Canada do you want to live in? What kind of world do you want to live in? Don't assume you are just a passenger to your life. Imagine that you might be one of the drivers. Well, if you're one of the drivers, in which direction do you want to drive? It's your life. And don't forget that. And don't, you know, listen respectfully to those who are older, who are sort of suggesting somehow that the life that everybody has now is necessarily your life in the future, except it'll be worse because, of course, nothing is as good as, you know, when we as adults were kids. No, don't buy it. Listen, but don't buy it. Assume that you, in fact, can make something better than what your parents created and what your grandparents created. And think of it that way and approach it that way. And so that's what we've done for the last year. So it's 4 years at McGill, but always with the idea that if it works, why not more than one school? So last year, Calgary wanted to do it, so McGill and Calgary. This year, it's McGill, Calgary, Ryerson, Saskatchewan, and Memorial in Newfoundland. And we do it in real time, you know, real classrooms, real students, in each classroom, split screens, if not multiple screens, and you can see your fellow students in the other campuses and interacting and so on. But always with the idea that, again, you know, in this creative place called a university, in this creative time, then what? You know, what might one create? And I'll just leave this part of it by saying that the whole idea is also working towards 2017. 2017, 150th anniversary of Canada, and it's just kind of a natural, normal time where there comes to be a focus on us. And so governments will spend money on what happens, companies will, community organizations will. There will be lots of energy, lots of attention, lots of celebration, lots of joy. And the question is that will there be something else? And in 1967, with the 100th anniversary, a lot of it was bricks and mortar. It was new community centers. And it was new libraries. It was new centennial hockey rinks. But it doesn't have to be bricks and mortar. It can be the kind of conversations and focus that can kind of generate something that can have a greater effect on a community than the bricks and mortar can. And so it's a natural time for any of us to say, well, gee, you know, where have we been? Where have we come from? How did we get here? Where are we going? Is this where we want to go? And so if instinctively it is a time to do that, well then, how do you create sort of structures to encourage that and to allow that? And so part of it, maybe with this university course, but part of it, and it's taken a while to sort of evolve into it, but what I would really love to see, and we'll see if it happens, is first of all, is to understand that 2017 doesn't need to be just a commemoration of the past. What it can be, even more significantly, is an expression of us in the future. And so that becomes the focus. It's not what we've done. It's not the celebration of those who have done it. It is being respectful of all of that, but it is, okay, now what is it that we are? And it's not to get talking heads on television who will sound wise about, you know, this Canada, it's a place of great diversity, and it's a place of the, you know, patience and politeness and all the rest of it. No, that's okay. But what is it that we really are? And I think what we are is what we do. And what I would love to see in 2017 is on television and in newspapers and in every other kind of platform, is getting up close to people who are doing really interesting things. And I think every one of you in this room knows somebody who is doing something really interesting. And probably almost nobody knows about it, and it may be, you know, something small or seemingly small within your community, within your church group, with whatever, and that it's just wow. I mean that what that person is doing, and am I ever glad that somebody like that exists and exists in my world? Well, to do that again and again and again and again and again through that year of 2017 and all across the country and in, again, tiny places where things never happen, but of course they do. and experiencing, for all, having all of us the chance to experience all of these things that are going on and that are absolutely inspirational. And they may not, you know, that not necessarily inspirational in the sense of, well, I want to do exactly what they're doing in their particular field, but in your own field, and just finding it inspirational in that way. And if we really want to know what the country is about, it isn't, you know, what our laws say, it isn't what our speakers will say, it's what we do again and again and again and again. And at the end of that year, that people who have kind of followed that will kind of have that sense of a collective portrait of the country. Aha, this is what we are. This is why I feel as I do. This is why this future that we have ahead of us is very exciting. So I think that really, I'll end it here, and then we'll go on into comments and questions. But to approach these things as, you know, as we are Canada, you know, that all of those things that we do, that individuals do, that collectively we are Canada. This community of Canadians are those who are defining what it is we are. This community of Canada that is us, that makes us better. And again, you know, this Canada, just like the examples I used before of growing up at a time that we did where we did, of the time at Cornell, of the time in Montreal, and of arriving into those communities and being made better by those communities, that in fact, you know, that's why community matters. That's why the theme that you focus on matters. Community makes us better. Community will make us better. Community and community building absolutely still matter. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dryden. Wow. So I've been noticing the tweets going up, and I have to share with you that there are several folks obviously watching on Sheridan TV, and we've had a couple of tweets actually from our president, who's enjoying it from somewhere in the world, but he's been enjoying it as well. So we do have, before we formally thank Mr. Dryden, we do have opportunity for questions from the floor. And I think we've got a couple of roving microphones. So Kathy over there, we might need some house lights. There we go. So Kathy over there, stage left, and Priya over here. So for those that have questions, we have a few minutes to entertain questions.
Thank you, Mr. Dryden, for coming to talk to us today. Hearing you is a reminder of me watching videos of the Summit Series and feeling so patriotic, because listening to you today, I don't think there's much of a difference. In 2005, you spoke about the bilateral agreements that you worked out with the provinces on a national child care system, and it didn't happen. What needs to happen, in your opinion, for the future to keep a national child care system on the political agenda until it is an actual defined system in Canada? Thank you.
Well, that's a very good question. And the first answer I'll give you will be a short answer, and it'll sound flip, but there is some truth to it, and then I'll go further into it, is that there won't be huge leap forward, any leaps forward on this until there is a different government in Ottawa. And that's only because different parties have different priorities. And the Conservative Party has its priorities, and a lot of people really like its priorities. And insofar as the Liberals and NDP are concerned, that child care is more of a priority. And so that's part of it. One of the things, though, that was really interesting to me, and Monica was there as well, that in November of 2014, there was a national conference of child care in Winnipeg. And Winnipeg seems to be, you know, kind of the unofficial home and almost birthplace of childcare. I mean, there's a bit of a pride of place there as Saskatchewan feels towards healthcare. And in 1984, there had been a small national conference in Ottawa, I think, in the 1970s, but the first really big one was in Winnipeg in 1984. And then the second one was in Winnipeg in 2004, and the third one in Winnipeg in 2014. And what was really, I think, a surprise to everybody, even those who, you know, kind of are work in the area day to day, was that they kind of assume that when the government changed in 2006 and the agreements were nullified, is that things kind of stopped then, and that it's been kind of 8 lost years. But in fact, when all of the people were there, they started to realize, no, actually, we've done a lot in 8 years. We had forgotten that how much we have done in 8 years. And a number of individual provinces have done a huge amount, Ontario being one of them, but a number of other provinces too. And so things did not stand still over that period of time. And so and things are far more advanced now, far more thinking has gone into it, far more smart and strategic thinking has happened in these last years, and that the moment at which there is a greater opportunity, then you've got more prepared people that are ready to make take more advantage of that opportunity. So I think that that anything that has to do with learning is the future, and that you can lose for 5 years or 8 years or 10 years, but ultimately you'll win forever if it relates to education and learning, and childcare does. And so whatever period of time that things have been slowed down, eventually they'll speed back up again, and that something more pronounced, more natural, instinctive, and just fundamentally there will come to be. And I don't think that that's that long, into the future. Is there anybody else? Yeah.
So I just wanted to say something. I have an article here, and it talks about poverty, and it's saying that the national problem has not just lingered, and it's worse than it was in 1989, and more than 1.3 million children across the country, 550,000 of them in Ontario, live in poverty, according to the authors of a 2014 report on childcare family poverty in Ottawa. And it says here that despite the pledge in Ottawa it made exactly 25 years ago today to eliminate child poverty by 2000, and in the province's promise in 2008 was to reduce poverty by 25% by 2013. So I'm wondering, since we're falling behind in our goals to eliminate this. What do you think we have to do as a community to get involved to help people? Because one person can be empowered to want to help somebody, but how do we empower everyone else to feel the way that we do?
Well, that's a very good question, and it kind of goes into a lot of different areas. I think that the first thing that has to happen, and in some ways it relates to the beginnings of my last answer, is that you have to have a government in power that is really committed to this. And I don't even mean really committed. I mean really, really, really committed to it. Because all of us, when we take on something, we think we're committed. But then there are lots of obstacles to doing something that is big and that matters, and where there have been obstacles in the way in the past. And so there are going to be down times. There are going to be moments that are not going to work. And you've got to be really, really, really committed for it to happen. In 1989, that wasn't the, I mean, that I think it was a unanimous vote of the House of Commons, but it was of the House of Commons. It wasn't the government in power, and on a question like that, which was a private member's bill, is that private members' bills have no impact, no concrete, actual, practical impact if there are money implications. And of course, for something like that, there are money implications. So you've got everybody who is naturally going to say that that's what they want to see happen and genuinely want to see it happen, but unless there is that it is the government rather than in general the will of the House of Commons that is saying this is what we are going to do and this is how we're going to do it and these are the benchmarks and this and that, it's not going to happen. The most interesting example, I think, that the last couple of years I was in Parliament, I traveled around the country a lot talking on this same question. And the most interesting example was the Labour government in the UK. And they had come to power in, I forget, 1998 or something like that. And they made a commitment to reduce youth unemployment. Not youth unemployment, sorry. The youth poverty by, it was 25% by, I think it was 6 years later, and then another 25% by 5 years after that, and then, kind of on the way to doing better after that. And that was a very central commitment that they made, and there were two driving forces to it. The first real driving force was the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Gordon Brown, the second most powerful person in that government. And the other person who was, fundamentally front and center committed was the Prime Minister, Tony Blair. And you almost never, ever get the two most powerful people in a government that centrally committed to something. And they were. And for the first, 3 or 4 years, they pretty much held to the standard of getting to reduce things by 25%, within the first 6 years. They weren't there, but they weren't too many percentage points behind. But of course, then what happened afterwards, and again, it's something that you don't entirely know when you're getting into it, is that the first 25% is the easiest. The next 25% is harder. It's, those who are more, for a longer period of time, they've been living in poverty. They are less educated. They are, then you start to get into the homeless and you have multiple barriers to doing better. And so they were not that far behind in the first 5 or 6 years, but then they started to really fall behind. And then it was kind of, they weren't going to make it. And the other thing that happened to them that again was almost The best possible scenario is that eventually, because this is a, you know, this is a big task that takes a long time, is that there are going to be changes of government. Or if not, there's going to be a change at the top of the government that is in power, and that's what happened. Tony Blair left, but who should become the prime minister? Gordon Brown. Again, what luck that the person who was sort of the spirit of this campaign was the one who moved from being the Chancellor of the Exchequer to becoming the Prime Minister. And so the commitment continued in a way that usually doesn't happen with governments. And it continued, but then, you know, that it slowed down. They started to get disappointed as the results weren't coming in. The commitment started to flag a little bit, and other things came up. And then, not long after that, Labour lost, and a new government came in. And while they were committed to reduce, they weren't really, really, really committed. And so then things, you know, just faded off. So that's a very long preamble to the answer to your question. But I think the first thing, and the only thing that gets you anywhere near achieving something significant in this way, is a government that decides this really, really, really matters, and this is going to be central. It's not going to be one of 20 things that really, really matter. It's going to be one of a couple that really, really matter, and then you stay with it, and you challenge yourself with these kinds of standards, that you achieve a certain level by a certain point, and then by the next point, and then by the next, you know, point after that. But it's not an easy one. It does take that kind of commitment. Is there somebody else? Okay, sir.
Thank you very much for all of your inspiring words about community building from your experiences. One thing I noticed is that there's a lot of initiatives that are happening on more of a government level. So the things that are happening through politics and policy making, and we also have initiatives on the community level. But I'm wondering what your thoughts are on bridging the gap between two different people that sometimes seem to have completely opposite ideas on how to affect positive change.
Well, that's a very interesting question, and it's one that we talk about a fair amount in the class that I do, and it came up just, was it this past week or the week before? Actually, it was just in this last week, and the theme was public engagement and politics, and the kind of natural, easy phrase that comes out is, that younger people aren't interested in kind of in the world around them, and as evidence of that, look at the voting, rates, and that, as a country, we're only around 60% in federal elections, and for those under 30, they're at 22% or, whatever the number happens to be. And so there is evidence that younger people just are not interested in the world around them. And as came up in this discussion is, well, not necessarily. That public life is not just politics. Doing things, within a public is not just through the political system. And that in fact, I think what is happening to a considerable extent is that younger people in particular are saying, and it's not just younger people, it's older people as well, but they look at politics and say, this doesn't seem like it's a part of our life. It seems strange and distant, and people who say things and do things and it doesn't reflect me so far as I'm concerned, and it doesn't look as if it wants to reflect me or to engage me or to involve me, and so why should I be involved in politics? There are lots of ways of being interested in your community, and either your immediate community or your larger community or the global community. And lots of instruments. You know, politics is not the only instrument. And in fact, I think what is happening is politics is becoming this and this and this and this in terms of its place in people's lives, and other instruments and structures are becoming this and this and this and this in terms of, and a lot of it is community groups, nonprofit groups, and other ways of expressing oneself within a community. And that's a real problem for politics. It's not necessarily a problem for those issues, but I think that ideally that it would be that on those questions, that it would be nice if there was significant engagement on both sides of it. But I think that what is happening is that there's less and less and less engagement on the politics side of it. And that essentially a lot of people are saying, if you're going to forget me and ignore me, I'm going to forget and ignore you. I'm going to get on with my life. These things that affect my life, you know, whether it's climate change or poverty or something, if you are not going to be central to the answer, it's not as if the answer doesn't matter. It just means that the answer is going to have to be found and worked at in a different way. And I think that what can happen over time, and I think will happen over time, is that the more and the better that individuals and groups do in working in these fields, that in fact politics will be under great pressure to respond and to kind of get their role back and part of their role back by earning it back in this way. But I don't think that's immediately around the corner. I think that politics still hasn't bottomed out in that way and still hasn't learned the lesson of the engagement of others in non-political ways, or non-big P political ways, I guess.
Right here.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Appreciate hearing you speak, and in anticipation of coming to hear you speak, thinking a lot about your status in the country, because it's really iconic, particularly, and I see even behind you the pictures of your experience with the Habs, talking about the summit series also reflected, and then combining that with your current project, talking about how we define Canada right now, how has your position as a Canadian icon influenced, motivated you, driven you into this new project of defining who we are right now?
I don't think at all. I mean, I don't think... icon's a weird word. And it used to be that former players were referred to as old timers, and then I guess some players or others decided that was a little disrespectful, so then we became legends, and now that icons kind of creeps into it. I think you just do. I mean, you know, that you don't set out to be, in my instance, I mean, play in the NHL. I never thought that was going to happen. I was a kid from Etobicoke. If I was lucky, I'd play through to the end of college hockey. And then that would be it. Or in any of these other things, you just do them because, you know, you think they matter. Might not be right, and others may not think you're right, but you think they matter, and you think that it's worthwhile trying, and that if somebody else can do it, let them do it. If maybe it's not obvious that others are willing to do it, well, then maybe it's worthwhile trying, and you just do it. And then whatever happens, happens. And it's, I mean, I remember when I was, you know, when I was playing and going to law school, the journalists would say, they would say, well, geez, it's great you're going to law school. You know, when you finish playing, you'll have something to fall back on. Fall back on. I mean, that even if you're lucky, you play until you're 35 or something, you've got, 50 years of your life ahead of you and 30 years of your work life ahead of you. Do you want to be falling back for 30 years of work life and for 50 years of your life? No, you don't. I mean, you hope that the next thing is more interesting and more worthwhile. I mean, it doesn't mean it will be, and others may not think it is, but that's what you do, and you hope it may, turn out that way. But you just do it. And I mean, I think that some of the experiences I've had have allowed me to be virtually everywhere in the country and to have the chance to kind of, if you want to stay over an extra day, people are happy to put you up for an extra day. And rather than rushing to the airport and getting out of town. And in that extra day, you might experience something. You might learn something. You might come away with a bit of a feeling that adds to a bunch of other feelings, and then, who knows from there. So I think that those lives have helped a lot in terms of having the chance to experience Canada. But in terms of it, sort of generating some kind of, pressure or instinct to live up to an apparent standard. No, you just do it. And one of the things, and it was, I never understood this while I was playing. I never had an answer. I always gave answers that I could come up with, but were never, I knew they weren't quite right, but I couldn't come up with anything any better. And then when I was writing the game, it sort of struck me that in the first year that I played, when I had only played a few games, and then we went and won the Stanley Cup, and people would say, like, how could you do that? I mean, that those playoffs are so different, and the Bruins were the defending champions, and they were going to beat everybody, and all the rest. How could you handle all of that? And I had no answer, except later realized that maybe the one approach that I have is the best, the best, my best achievement. And that was, in that instance, it was, I didn't know I could do it, but I didn't know I couldn't. And you can't know that you can do it, or you know that you can do it, and so it's bravado, and it's like, oh, what's about this, and these guys aren't so good, and all the rest of it. But you're not likely fooling anybody, and you're not likely fooling yourself in it. And so you can't know, put into a new situation, and that's any of us, in any new situation, the first day of a new school or whatever it is, you can't know you can do it. Just so long as you don't know that you can't. That's the thing. I mean, if you understand that you can't, then it won't work. And you don't have to know you can, but you just, the other side. And then you just do. And then you find out. You find out whether you're ready to do it and whether you can do it or not. And most of us, most of the time, are actually more ready than we were and more ready than those people around us think that we would be. And that all of those years that we weren't doing this, we were actually doing aspects of this and we were learning certain things, and all of a sudden we're put in this position and, geez, we can do it. And we can do it because we were ready. And who knew? And so I think that's, you know, with any of these things, you know, that you hope it's important, you try, you don't know if it will work, you don't know if you can do it, but if it seems worthy enough, you try and you find out.
So I think we'll put an end to the questions at that point. That seems like an appropriately inspiring place to end, so thank you for that, Ken. I'm going to perhaps embarrass you for a moment if I could, but folks perhaps are not aware, well, you are aware that Ken is in demand across North America to speak, and on an annual basis travels all over North America giving talks in various venues. And what Ken typically does is he takes the proceeds from those talks and he contributes the proceeds to a scholarship fund under his name and provides scholarship for those that are less advantaged than others, than the rest of us perhaps. And so in his own humble way, and I'm sure Ken wouldn't tell you that he does this, he really makes a substantial difference. So this is a man that actually walks the talk, and I think that is incredibly admirable. But beyond that, Ken is taking a significant portion of the proceeds from this evening's talk, and he's contributing them back to us, our faculty, to the Faculty of Applied Health and Community Studies. And we're going to pull that contribution together with some fundraising that our students are going to be challenged to funds that they'll be challenged to raise. And starting next year, we're going to launch the Ken Dryden Community Builder Scholarship Fund. So I think this man deserves a round of applause. So we will work out the details of that and keep tuned. In the meantime, I would like to welcome to the stage our Associate Dean for the School of Community Studies, Dr. Mary Louise Noce, to formally thank Ken for his presentation.
Good evening, all. On behalf of the Faculty of Applied Health and Community Studies, I'd like to thank Mr. Dryden for sharing his insights on nation building and community building, for reminding us to take the back roads, acknowledging the learning around us, and attributing much deserved thanks to those that contribute to our success. In addition to that, inspiring us to ask questions around what we aspire to be as a community. Please accept this small token in our appreciation.
So I think I warned you that I talk too much. I'll make this really, really quick. Ken will be here for the next little bit, and he will be available to meet and greet you folks. But before we do that, a couple of folks that I do need to thank. Thanks to our communications and marketing folks, particularly Christine Sestak, who's here with us tonight. So thank you, Christine, for all of your help. Thanks also to Andrew Ness, who is a member of our President's Council and came tonight to support us. So thank you very much, Andrew. Would like to thank also our event planning folks. So they're the ones that put the nice little signs out on the road so you know how to find your way in here. So I want to acknowledge and thank them as well. Sure. And finally, an event like this takes a tremendous amount of planning. It's kind of like getting married, you know. So for a guy like me who doesn't do details, I'm in the background going, well, really, you need to do that? In any case, we had a tremendous amount to do to prepare for this event, and a large, large portion of it fell back on our faculty and fell back on our support staff. And the person really leading the charge through all of that, they all need to be thanked. But in this particular instance, we do need to acknowledge Priya Ramesh, who has done such a marvelous job. Put your hand up. Priya is back in the corner. Thank you, Priya. Appreciate that so much. For all the work has just been wonderful. So, Priya, could you direct me to the next place here? So where would you like Mr. Dryden? Out in the lounge? So, Monica, you can look after that. So thanks again, folks, and enjoy some of the food that remains. Take care.